Well, hi, and welcome to another segment of While We're Apart. We've been talking this week about coping with a complex. You know what a complex is. You know, people, in fact, the world talks about an inferiority complex, this complex or this feeling of feeling inferior. And this week we've talked about the awareness of it. We've talked about the adjustment to it. But finally, let's deal with the acceptance of it. Now, what about you? I mean, are you going to go through life with a complex? Or are you going to consider you and the Lord as a team and you not in competition with anyone else? In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, the Bible compares the local church, like Fargo Baptist Church, this church, to a body. And in a body like this, a church body, some of us might be the arm, some of us might be the hands, some might be the legs, some might be the toes, whatever it is. But God made you unique to be a part of a local church body. Now, years ago, my oldest son and my wife and I think Jared was at the time getting ready to, you know, launch out into life with his vocation, finishing up high school and so on. And so we took this test, and it was kind of to tell you what you were made to do, all right? And I scored high as a planner, a visionary, always thinking, that kind of thing. And it really read me to a T. You know, we're very different in personalities, and that's what makes the world go around. And basically, the test said, you know, I'm ADHD. And I've often said, in fact, my wife would back me up on this, if they would have had Ritalin back in the 60s, I'd have been on it. You know, I've often said it might be that we are drugging up our future leaders, the shakers and the movers. Now, somebody has to be the engineer who designs the buildings, and someone has to be the carpenter who builds the buildings. And inside of you, inside of your rib cage, there are some vital organs there that are unseen, but every member of the body is important. Now, in Romans 12:3, Paul says, "For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith." Now, the word soberly there, it's interesting. It means really not less than you should, not higher than you should, but having temperance even in the way we think of ourselves. Not, you know, I'm just a no-down low count, I'm just a dirty worm. No. And not having this, oh, aren't I somebody kind of an attitude, but really getting the balance here. And that's what Paul is saying, not to think of ourselves more highly than we ought to, but to think soberly. Bring the bar down to where it belongs, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. It's all God. It's all God. So basically, just be honest in the estimate of yourself. You know, we find a fellow back in the Old Testament by the name of Amos, and we don't preach out of Amos a whole lot like one of the Gospels or the Epistles, but Amos was quite a character. He was a farmer. Amos had no formal training in school, and he was just this common guy, had all the reasons in the world to have a complex. Unlike Solomon, he wasn't a king, or Paul, you know, with his double PhD, or Daniel living in a palace. Amos was a fig picker. So he didn't have any nice clothes. And so he comes into the court of the king to prophesy in rough garments, but he doesn't back down a bit. He says in so many words, "I didn't ask for this job. The only credentials I have is God's calling." And he goes with it. Now, how do we overcome a complex? Well, the Bible says in 1 John 3:20, "For if our heart condemn us, God is greater than our heart and knoweth all things." If our heart condemn us, God's greater than our heart. And by the way, the heart is deceitful above all things, according to Jeremiah 17:9. Who can know it? So we listen to our hearts really when we shouldn't. We should listen to God. God is greater than our heart. And we're the crowning part of God's creation. I read somewhere there's enough atomic power in the human body to destroy New York City. I'm not sure how that works, but it's almost impossible to figure out, I mean, how fearfully and wonderfully God has made us. You know, if they were to build a computer that would even match your brain, it would be the size of a city block, 22 stories high, and even then not even be able to perform a fraction of the functions of your brain. You know, the power of your brain is phenomenal. And yet, here we are, we cower in inferiority and in timidity. You know, there's a principle in the New Testament from Matthew 6:26, where Jesus says, "Are you not worth much more than that sparrow?" All right? Much more, infinitely more. Christ implies in another place that you're worth more than the whole world. So when you get to feeling low, remember, you're the object of God's attention and God's favor, and the reason He sent His Son to this earth to die. You're worth much to Him. You are independently being worked on by God Himself. We looked at it the other day. Philippians 1:6, being confident of this very thing, that He which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. You are being worked on by God Himself. So don't compare yourself to somebody else, all right? Philippians 2:13 says, "For it is God which worketh in you, both to will and to do of His good pleasure." God's working on you. God's working in you. You're a VIP to God. God sent His Son because He loves you. And in Romans 8:29, the Bible says, "For whom He did foreknow, He also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren." So God wants you to be like His Son, and we are His workmanship. Ephesians 2:10 says, "For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them." So when you have the right esteem, the proper esteem, everything else falls into place. You're able to love folks. You're able to compliment other folks. You're able to help others. You're able to even be glad for another's blessings. And so you don't have to stoop in humility, you know, smiting yourself, "I'm such a worm," and so on. No, have the proper evaluation. You know, the Bible says it's salvation. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new." Imagine that. Even that complex, that inferiority complex, "All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new." And if we're not doing that, we're not appropriating the available grace that God has given to us to overcome that past, that complex. I close with this verse. In Ephesians 1:6, and I love this verse, it speaks of the praise of the glory of His grace, wherein He hath made us accepted in the Beloved. Oh, rejoice in that a little bit, and revel in that a little bit, and wallow around in that a little bit, that He hath made us accepted in the Beloved. So you don't have to measure up. You don't have to prove something. You don't have to perform a certain way for God to accept you. He already has accepted you. He hath made us accepted in the Beloved. What a thought to close with. Well, I hope you have a great day, and I hope you can take something with you, a takeaway from what we've been talking about today in the last few days. And with that, we'll see you tomorrow on While We're Apart. Have a great day.
When we asunder part, it gives us inward pain, but we shall still be joined in heart and hope to meet again.